Would you pray with me? Father, as we get ready to look into your word today, Father, there may be things in it that challenge what we think. There may be things that challenge what we have heard, what we have decided that we believe already, that may challenge our notions of goodness or fairness even, things that make us uncomfortable sometimes. Father, I pray that as we hear, that we would consciously submit to the authority of this word as we're submitting to you, the word giver. And Father, that we would respond to your Holy Spirit because you're the one that's teaching us on a deep level, deeper than anything I could say that might persuade or challenge. But Father, you're speaking to hearts. And so Father, may we hear and respond. And Father, as always, my prayer is this. It's very easy for us to turn ourselves into some sort of philosophers, thinking and pondering, considering and discussing and debating what your word says. But Father, we want to be obedient disciples today. People who have said Jesus is a good and worthy king to follow. His rule and reign is perfect and just and loving, and we want to live for him and under him and obey him. So Father, may that be so. May we do something with what we hear today. And that's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I want to paint a scenario for you this morning. It may sound a bit far-fetched at the beginning, but I promise when you get to the end of the little scenario that I'm going to describe, it's probably going to address or at least ask a question that you've either discussed with someone before or someone has discussed with you before. So imagine this scene, if you will. So you got a young couple, and say they're on a sailing excursion, just the two of them and maybe an infant son. Tragedy falls on them, the ship is capsized, their lives are lost, but somehow miraculously, this infant child of theirs washes ashore on a deserted island. On this deserted island, this child grows up with zero exposure to the rest of the world. There's no media there. There's no communication there with any other person or any other entity besides just the stuff that's around them, the animals and the whatnot around them. And they grow up in this deserted situation for the rest of their life, never hearing another human voice, never reading a book, never hearing a Bible story, never having anyone share with them the gospel or the four spiritual laws track or anything like that. Here's my question for you. That person that grows up on that island, that proverbial man on the island, when they die and they stand before God, what happens? What happens to them? What is the verdict on the day of judgment for someone like that? Now, I'm asking you that question with the assumption that you already believe some of the things that I believe, that everyone dies, it's appointed unto men once to die, and that after death there is judgment, that everyone's going to see God. So again, what happens to them when they die? Well, while the scripture may not give the exact answers to that specific question, because that's sort of a modern construct, I think, you know, what happens to this proverbial male on the island, it does give us all that we need to know doctrinally, theologically, to be able to answer that question definitively. And the answer is found in Romans chapter 1, starting in verse 18. If you got your Bible with you, open it to Romans chapter 1. If you'd like to use one of those new Bibles in the pew racks in front of you, please feel free. We'd love to get those broken in and well used. Romans chapter 1, you can read the same version that I'll be reading this morning. We're going to read verses 18 through 23. God's word says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth." Now let me pause. If we're not careful, that very first verse will throw some of you so off track that you won't hear the rest of anything that I say. Because I'm proposing a concept or a reality about God that a lot of people honestly deny today. And if they don't deny it outright, they certainly don't spend any time thinking about it, considering it, or fearing it. And that is the reality of the dual natures of God. On the one hand, as we have so often talked and heard and probably grown up hearing, God is love. He doesn't just love. As Jeremy described for us today, God demonstrates his love for us. We know what love is because of God. He's the originator. He's the definer of. He's the ultimate giver of love. God is perfectly loving. But God is also perfectly holy. Okay, so you've got these dual natures of his character. He loves us, and yet because he's holy and he's just, he has to treat us or deal with us according to sin. Our sins require something. And what those sins require is his wrath. And as I'm going to hopefully paint a picture for you today, that wrath that God has for us is perfectly justifiable. It's perfectly fair, and it makes perfect sense. Now, I know that's not the part of the character of God that most of the world wants to hear. We much prefer a God that just accepts us like we are, is fine with whatever we do, and ultimately exists to make us happy and give us the things that we want. But it's not a biblical picture of God. And the Bible says this about God. Here's the reality again. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness. That's all unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. So here's what we know about God. If you have a pretty good working understanding of the book of Romans, there's probably one verse, I would guess, among others that you know pretty well, Romans 3:23. What does it say? For all have what? What percentage? All. Everyone has sinned. All have sinned. All have fallen short of the glory of God. Now, the Bible says something there explicitly and something implicitly. Okay, the explicit is we all have sinned. There's no denying that. And really, honestly, I've never met anybody in conversation, whether they were close to God or far from God, that really honestly denied that. We start to really pinpoint, is there any wrong that you've ever done? Is there any shortfall in your life? Is there anything in you that's less than who God is? And really, no one ever honestly denies that. But this passage says something else about that. Because of that sinful condition, we do something. We suppress truth. Our sinfulness changes the way that we think about things. Listen to the rest. So we who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth, for what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. So they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their understanding, futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools, and they exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things, or all sorts of false gods. Now, before we get too far into the wrath of God and the implications of that wrath and the condition of man, not just that proverbial man on the island, but every person in the world, religious or irreligious, their condition apart from God, let's answer a basic question first, a fundamental question. When we talk about the gospel, if you were here last week, you remember our passage was this. Paul said this great statement, this profound statement that serves as sort of the baseline of our whole teaching in the book of Romans. He said, I am not ashamed of the gospel. Why? For it is the power of God unto salvation for all who believe. How is it the power of God for salvation? Why? For in it, verse 17, the righteousness of God is revealed. In it, the righteousness of God is revealed. When we say gospel, we're saying at its most basic level that the gospel means good news. This is the good news from God. Now, here's my question for you. I want you to think about this for a moment. What makes the gospel good? What makes that good news? What would make that, if you're hearing this, maybe for the first time or understanding it for the first time, why should that fall on your ears and hit your heart as something that is profoundly good? What makes the gospel good news? Well, the answer is in those passages we just read a moment ago, starting in verse 18. The wrath of God. You see, the gospel is good news because it displaces bad news. The bad news is this. The wrath of God is revealed against all the unrighteousness of men. That means there's nobody, nowhere, pardon my grammar, there's nobody nowhere who will sin and get away with it, or else God ceases to be just and holy. And so God will judge all the unrighteousness of all men, all times, all places. That's holiness. That's justice. And that's bad news, folks, right? Would you agree? Nod your head if you're with me. That's bad news. If God is going to not omit, God is not going to overlook any sin of any person, anywhere, anytime, and if all sin leads to death, the wages of sin is death, that's news of the worst sort. So what makes the gospel good news when you hear it? Because the good news is the righteousness of God revealed. So the righteousness of God now meets the unrighteousness of man. And the good news of the gospel is the only antidote to the wrath of God rightly poured out on the unrighteousness of men is that God would give his own righteousness in its place in the person of Christ. So when you get a young monk like Martin Luther, some 500 years ago, studying through the scriptures, profoundly, profoundly depressed about his own spiritual condition, as he realizes it's impossible to reach God, it's impossible to earn God's holiness and God's favor on his own, when he finally, by the ministry of the Holy Spirit in him, he finally understands what Romans 1:17 is saying, the righteousness of God revealed, that God, instead of judging us in righteousness, grants us righteousness. He gives it to us. He says, this passage became for me the pathway to heaven. That's what makes the gospel good. That's what makes it good news. It is the only sufficient antidote to the wrath that is deserved. God's righteousness taking the place of our unrighteousness. So now let's get back to that proverbial man on the island that I described. I want to ask you how many of you have had a conversation like that or thought about that, but I'll bet you a lot of you have. What happens to that person who's never heard the gospel? No one has ever given them a Bible. No one has ever shared a Bible story with them. No one's ever given them their testimony. They've never even heard the name of Jesus. When they stand before the Almighty one day, the one true God, maker of heaven and earth, what happens to them? Well, let's answer some questions. A seminary professor, a professor of theology at Southern Seminary where I attended, once asked the class these three questions about this man on the island. I'm going to try to answer his three questions. First one is this. Is the man on the island ignorant? Now, when I say ignorant, I'm not talking about like an insult, like, you know, you're so ignorant. No. I'm talking about is he unknowing? Is he justified in not knowing what he doesn't know, what he's supposed to know? Is the man on the island ignorant? Well, according to Scripture, the man on the island, though he may claim to be otherwise, is no atheist. He is no atheist. In fact, let me make a claim for you based on Scripture, not based on opinion. I believe according to Scripture, thus according to God himself, there really is no such thing as an atheist. And I think sometimes if you really press someone who claims to be an atheist, what they will finally acknowledge to you is, I'm really just not sure. And they'll try to put the burden of proof on you. You have to prove to me there's a God because I just can't find the proof. That by definition is agnostic. That I can grant. Atheist I cannot. Nor does Scripture grant it. The person is not an atheist because the Bible says there are certain things about God that he has revealed to them. He has shown himself to them. He's not an atheist. What he is, though, is a condition we call denial. He's in denial about what he sees all around him. Because here's what Romans chapter 1 is telling us. Not only does God show that he is God, that there is a God, Romans 1 goes even farther than that and says God even shows us what kind of God he is, right? Shows what kind of God he is. It says, according to the Scripture, what can be known about God has been made plain to them. Invisible attributes, namely these two things, power and nature. Well, what do we know about God's power? Well, we see it in creation. We see it in the forces that are existing all around us. Maybe that proverbial man on the island sits there and he sees a tropical storm, a torrential downpour. Maybe he sees the crashing of the wind and waves or just the repetition. Every single day, the same thing happens. The sun rises, the sun sets. And he sees all these things happen around him. Maybe he's a particularly thoughtful sort who thinks about himself. And he wonders, how did I get this way? And the things that I can see and hear and understand. Or maybe he begins to study the animals around him or the plant life. And he sees this power and then this nature, this specificity of design and this detailed, orderly world that we live in. And the power and the majesty and the beauty. Who painted all this? Who created all this? And the Scripture is saying God is showing something about himself. So the person here is in denial, but denial with a motive. What's the motive? If creation, if design, if general revelation, the picture of who God is in this world all around us, says something about God. But we look at all of that and we say, there is no God. Or as Romans chapter 1 says, they became fools. Then what's the motive for our denial? The motive is what I would call autonomy or self-rule or even rebellion. Because the person seeing all these things consciously decides, I don't want there to be a God. So for those of you struggling in a college course, you got a professor who says that they're an atheist. You got a friend who says, you know, I've studied all these different religions of the world, and I believe they're all false. I don't believe any of them. For those of you who waste your time watching Bill Maher on HBO or something like that, and say, no, he's a real atheist. He really is. No, they are consciously atheistic by choice, and their motive is this. If this God who made everything made me, then common sense says, simple logical deduction says, I'm under him now. if he sets everything in order that is, how the earth turns and how the waves crash and how the sun sets and everything else that I see all around me, from every animal that I see, every plant that I see grow, everything I know about myself, if God orchestrates all of this, then God has a sovereign working plan, and that speaks to authority. And so the real challenge here for the would-be atheists is this: they've got to deny a lot of what God reveals about himself in order to not have that God be an authority over them. And so this is a conscious atheism. This is a chosen atheist. Stephen Colbert recently had an interview with Ricky Gervais. I didn't watch it live. Someone sent me the link about it, and so I watched the video, and very interesting, he sort of prods Ricky about his supposed atheism, sort of eggs him on to get into a little debate about why he's atheist, and he starts off with a good and pointed, really rather classical question. This is what he asks him: why is there something rather than nothing? Why is there something rather than nothing? Of course, Gervais good-naturedly dismisses it and raises a different question, maybe more pointed. How is there something rather than nothing? How is there something? So in other words, he wants to turn it to not a who, but a what, a science debate, a debate about what we know about science. But the original question still remains, but why is there original cause and purpose? Now, an article about this, someone wrote in a blog, said Gervais then scored a rhetorical point by saying there are around 3,000 different deities floating around the religious landscape. Colbert believes in one, and so Gervais suggests he therefore disbelieves in 2,999. So in other words, I'm only a little bit more atheist than you are. You deny 2,999, I deny 3,000. We're really not that different. I'm just adding one more to the list. Now that would seem like an effective response, but it really is not. Because what we're really talking about is a quest for truth. Is there a God? Is there a central cause? Is there an originator of everything? Is there somebody responsible for all of this? Is there an engineer? Is there a designer? Is there an artist in all of this? So it's really not about selective atheism, but just trying to figure out what's true, what's real. But here's where Colbert misses moment in this debate. And unfortunately, he sort of ceded the point. Gervais says this. He says, if you take all the religious books of the world, all that have ever been written, of every religious type and sort, every religious group, he said, if you destroy them all, if you effectively burn them all, he said, 1,000 years from now, they would all be gone. They would never be remembered again. But if you burn every science book, every mathematic text, if you destroyed all of those, he said, within 1,000 years, those would all reappear, because science is what it is. All those findings would be found again. All those discoveries would be discovered again. All those formulas would be rewritten again. Now, again, Colbert says, good point. And he's right, but not for the reason that he supposes. Because according to Romans chapter 1, what would happen again is that people again would discover the God who's revealing himself, the God who's making himself known. So what would actually happen if all those religious texts were gone, we would still see a world that cries out, there is a God. We would still see a creation that cries out, there's a particular kind of God, a God with a particular set of power and skills and design and character traits. All those would still point to God. Everything still would favor the existence of God. And that's what Paul is talking about. In the NIV, it says, what may be known about God is plain to them because God has made it plain. And those things would still emerge. And because of what we know about the character and nature of God, God would still be at work revealing himself in this world. That's what he does. So can we say that the man on the island is ignorant? No, not really. There's far too much evidence. Scripture says God has made himself plain and certain aspects about his character that are plain. But even in that revelation, man has refused it. So what does the scripture say about those things? As he refuses these things, not only does he not want to believe in these things, but he does not want to submit to them. He does not believe nor worship the God who reveals himself. So here's the second question. The second question then is this. Is this man on the island, no exposure to other people, no exposure to other cultures, no exposure to God's written law, no scriptures, no Bibles, no Bible stories, is he innocent? Is he innocent? I remember, and I've shared this illustration with you before, let me share it in the context of today. I still have this vivid memory of being late for work one day and coming from my neighborhood, I'm crossing over two lanes and a turning lane in the center trying to get into my church office. There's a sidewalk that runs down the front of the church, and really I was just paying attention to the traffic going east and west, and so really didn't pay attention to what was happening on the sidewalk. So as I'm buzzing across the street, just as I'm crossing the sidewalk, big impact on the side of my car. Now, the police wrote it down that I hit him, but really hit me because his bicycle hit my door. I didn't really hit the bicyclist. He hit me, but that's beside the point. And I was a little frustrated. I felt bad for the kid. He's fine and all that, but collarbones, those heal easily. Everybody breaks collarbones, right? Doesn't take much to break a collarbone. It's like a chicken wing or something. Anyhow, he was fine. He wasn't even crying. So I'm talking with the police officer, and I said, okay, you know, I feel bad for him and everything, but really, should he's operating a vehicle, should he not have been on the road? He said, well, according to Florida law, a bicyclist is a pedestrian. That makes sense. And I said, okay, so, but the sidewalk is like, it's not side ride, it's sidewalk. Shouldn't he been, I mean, that's for walkers. He said, well, as a pedestrian, he has a right to the sidewalk. I said, that just doesn't make any sense. I just don't get that. I'm trying to argue the point. And he said, son, and he goes over to his police cruiser, pulls out this manual about the size of Shakespeare's completed works, and it is the Florida Motor Vehicle Statutes. And he said, read it. And that was the end of the case. So I didn't know the law, I was ignorant of it, but yet the law was there written. You know, that doesn't really apply to this man, does it? Because he didn't have the written law. I mean, I could have read that if I'd have wanted to. It's available to me. It's not hidden. I could have picked it up in a library. I could have read it online. I could have purchased my own copy should I have had the desire to. Maybe the question is more something like this. You show up here for Calvary at Sunday morning. You know, we have a very kind and good police officer at the door in uniform. That's to keep staff in check. It has nothing to do with you guys. So we have him at the door. But as you're opening the door, he denies you entrance. He said, no, you're not coming in here. He says, what do you mean? He says, you can't wear that in here. So what? I'm dressed perfectly appropriately. He says, yeah, but we don't allow purple in here. That's not one of our colors. You cannot wear purple in here. This doesn't make any sense. I'm sorry, you're not coming in here wearing that. Well, no one's ever told me that. No, I'm sorry, it's an unwritten rule. But you can't have an unwritten rule and expect me to keep it out. That's just not what? It's not fair. And that really is the question that we're asking here, right? The real question that people are asking about the man on the island when we talk about innocence is fairness. Is that fair? Because I'm going to guess, I'm going to go out on a limb here, okay? When I posed the initial question just a little while ago, the proverbial man on the island who's never heard the gospel, never heard about Jesus, never heard about how to be saved, never heard a plan of salvation or a gospel story, I'm going to guess that some of you had already made up your mind. You already had an answer to that. Well, I know what happens. He goes to heaven. How can he be guilty of something he doesn't know? But what does the scripture say about that? It actually addresses this in Romans chapter 2. Let me read the passage to you. Romans chapter 2, verse 12. We'll spend a little more time in this in a couple of weeks. For all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law. And all who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. Listen, this is heady stuff. This is weighty. All who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law. All who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. So you got two categories of people loosely here, right? You got those people who have been exposed to the law of God. That would primarily be the Jews that Paul's addressing here. They know the law of God. They know what they should have done that they have not done. So they're judged by what they know and have failed to do, right? Makes sense. But what about those who have also sinned, though they didn't know the law? What happens to them? Well, Scripture says the same thing happens. They still perish. Why? Look at verse 14. When Gentiles, literally pagans, who do not have the law, by nature do what the law requires, they are a law to themselves, even though they don't have the law. They show that the work of the law is written on their hearts, while their conscience also bears witness, and their conflicting thoughts accuse or even excuse them. On that day, when according to my gospel, God judges the secrets of men by Christ Jesus. How do we know that people have the law already written on their hearts? How do we know this? Because that's what he's saying. We make this argument for innocence, say he doesn't have the law, he's got nothing. How would he know what he did wrong? It's not fair. But God's word says he actually does have the law. There's a portion of it written on his heart. How do we know that everybody's got the law written on their heart? Now you may argue, hey, I know some people, they don't know right from wrong at all. I'm telling you. I've known this guy since I've grown up, and he does not know right from wrong, good from evil. This is the worst guy you've ever met. He's bad news. He's got no clue. I mean, he's a straight-up sociopath, psychopath, whatever category you want to give him. And then maybe you would go down the list of things that he does, right? Man, he will think nothing of stealing from you. He would think nothing of picking a fight with you and cheap-shotting you right in the mouth. He thinks nothing of cheating on his girlfriend or abusing his kids. He thinks of nothing of those things. Let me ask you, that guy that you know that sounds like a great friend for you to have, what does he think when you steal from him? What does he think when you abuse him in some way? What does he think when you do wrong by him? Does he have a sense of right and wrong then? Or let me pose the question a little differently. Does he ever do right? Is there ever any good thing that he does? Does he do right by his own children sometimes? Or what about his mama? Does he treat his mama good? Defend her honor sometimes? You see, the very fact that we do good sometimes shows that we've got a law written in our hearts. He says that's what the Gentiles do. We may sin acting as if, or people may even think that we don't know good, but when others sin against us, we know. And we ask this question here. Again, let's go back to the question of fairness. Is God fair here? How you answer this, how you answer that question speaks volumes about what you understand about yourself and what you understand about God. And the answer to God's fairness, I have to say, is absolutely foundational to understanding Scripture and foundational to understanding Romans. I joked with somebody the other day, the easy messages from Romans are over. Those are the ones about your identity and the gospel. Now it gets tough. How we answer this speaks volumes about us. You see, because some of us are laboring under the false notion that man is essentially good. He's essentially good. At his core, man is a good person, wants to do good things, wants to do what's right. He's a good person, a good heart. And God looks at our good hearts, our sincerity, and God rewards that. And at the same time, you have a notion of God, that God owes us something. That it's God's responsibility some way. That, you know, it's just not fair if God doesn't do his part. God owes us something. In a book called Faith Comes by Hearing, authors Christopher Morgan and Robert Peterson write this. How could it be fair and just for those who have never even had a chance to hear the gospel, which is necessary for salvation, to be condemned to hell? The question sounds powerful, but behind it lies faulty assumptions. What are these faulty assumptions? The first mistaken assumption is that our condemnation is based on a rejection of the gospel. Listen, Scripture teaches that our condemnation is based on the fact that we are sinners, not because at some point in time we rejected the gospel. Furthermore, God's wrath is revealed against everyone who suppresses his truth revealed through creation. So strictly speaking, the Bible denies that there are persons who have never heard of God. They go on to assert another faulty assumption, this one having to do with a confusion of justice and mercy. God is merciful in that he's provided a way of salvation via Christ for those who will accept him. But God is also just, and that unrepentance will not go unnoticed. Did you catch the rather controversial thing they wrote? Which may totally turn upside down your view of God, Scripture, and salvation. Nowhere in Scripture does it say that a person's guilt is based on their rejection of the gospel. Nowhere in Scripture does it say that a person's eternal destination is based on what they do with Jesus, the good news of the gospel. It doesn't say that. What the Bible says, in fact, is very clear. What condemns us is not a rejection or a refusal of the truth. What condemns us is sin. Sin. It's sin that condemns a person. And if all have sinned and will bear the righteous wrath of God, which is fitting in response to our sin, if God is holy and infinitely just and perfect in all of his ways, and man is not entirely good, but man is at his core a sinful person, then this changes everything. This changes everything. And so now our condition of innocence can no longer be argued. The man is not innocent. And here's a rather misleading and moot question that I think people ask sometimes. So people will look at this, and if we're debating this philosophically, they'll say something like this. Okay, so, all right, so he's got all creation around him. He's got a revelation of that God exists. He's got a certain sense of the character and nature of God, right? That God's attributes, his invisible attributes, his power. And so what if in that scenario, this person growing up on this island throws aside his coconut head God, stops worshiping the giant turtle that he sees periodically, and says instead, God that I don't know, maker of all that I don't understand, orchestrator of everything that I see here, I worship you. I submit myself to you. Then where do they stand? And I call this a moot and misleading question because the Bible says that person doesn't exist. It says that person doesn't exist. Romans chapter 3, verse 10. Listen to the emphatic statement here. Romans 3, verse 10. None is righteous. No, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. So again, while Paul is not trying to answer our philosophical debate like we're in a college classroom, he's debating or answering the question of God's fairness in the context of man's vast lostness. So to say, well, what if that person were to suddenly say, I want to worship God? That's not what Scripture teaches as to how a person ever finds God. In fact, the formula for how a person finds God is crystal clear in Romans. Do you know what it is? The Holy Spirit of God works through the faithful proclamation of the gospel of God, which causes a person to fall under the conviction of God, which leads them to repentance. Apart from that, there is none. Apart from that, there's nothing. And what about his supposed innocence? You say, well, how bad could it have been? He's never been around anybody. I mean, what was the worst thing he could do while he's there? What's the worst sort of sin he could be committing there? Was he like crushing little bird heads all day? You know, what's he guilty of exactly? Let me try a little experiment with you for a moment, okay? Why don't you just close your eyes? Everybody in the room, just close your eyes just for a second. Okay, you can open your eyes. I would suggest to you biblically that in those 5 seconds with your eyes closed, you committed enough sin to be worthy of eternal judgment of God. You say, whoa, that's wacky. I don't know what you were thinking about in those 5 seconds. I was just thinking about what you're going to say next. Some of you are just thinking about what you're going to eat next. But what is the law of God? What's the essence of the law of God? When someone approached Jesus and said, summarize it for me, condense it for me, let's reduce it to its most central denominator. So just give me the whole law. What did Jesus say? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Can any of us in this room claim in those 5 seconds that we were loving God with every part of our being and loving our neighbors ourselves? No, none of us could. We all fall short of that standard of God's perfection and God's glory. That's it, loving with everything that we are. So we can no longer argue that he's innocent. So here's the question. So what happens to him then? What happens to this man now? Well, the Bible teaches that he'll be judged. And he'll be judged based on the revelation that he had and that he rejected. He'll be judged based on the revelation that he had and that he rejected. Some people get a little squeamish at the thought of different levels of judgment, different levels of punishment, perhaps even different levels of hell. What do the Scriptures teach? Well, think about Jesus for a moment, what Jesus said. Here's the scene. We're in Matthew chapter 10. Jesus is sending out his disciples. He's sending them out in pairs, and he's teaching them the fundamentals of taking the gospel. It's a passage we looked at a few weeks ago, by the way. He's sending them into strange places, into strange homes, strange communities, and he gives them this sort of principle. Remember we talked about the person of peace? You find that person who's willing to receive you, willing to invite you into their home. You share the gospel with them. How do you know who a person of peace is? You got to go through a lot of people who are not people of peace. And here's what Jesus said about it. Listen to what he said. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it's not worthy, let your peace return to you. And if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet when you leave that house or town. Truly, I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah for that town. Did you catch that? So you go into a person's home and you share the gospel with them and they refuse it. Jesus says on the day of judgment, you would rather be godless pagan Sodom and Gomorrah, the towns that were destroyed by fire from heaven for their gross immorality. You would rather be them on that day than the person who refuses the gospel. It's not all he said about it. One chapter later, he reemphasizes it. Then Jesus began to denounce the cities where most of his mighty works had been done. This is Matthew 11, 20. He began to denounce the cities where most of his mighty works had been done because they did not repent. Here's what he said. Here's a quote. Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For the mighty works done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for Tyre and Sidon than for you. Two other cities that were destroyed by God's judgment. Here Jesus had revealed himself. Here Jesus had exposed the truth of the gospel. Here Jesus had demonstrated the power of God over and over and over, and they did not respond. And what did he say? Your judgment is worse. What about people who have had a lifetime of exposure to the gospel?
What about people who've sat in churches like this years, grew up in them, became an adult in them, became increasingly resistant to the truth claims of the gospel? So much so they could just dismiss it as just irrelevant to them, I guess. What happens to those people? Is this not what Hebrews 10:29 is describing? How much worse punishment do you think will be deserved by the one who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and has profaned the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has outraged the Spirit of grace? What happens to that religious person who has treated the gospel as something just simply to be walked on? It's the ordinary, everyday stuff. I've heard all that stuff. It means nothing to me. Scripture says, how much worse punishment to them. So he's not innocent, and yet his judgment will be less severe. His punishment will be less intense. His consequences will be different than those who reject more, those who have the full measure of the gospel given to them and refuse it. So it brings up a third question. The third question is this: does it matter? Is he important? Is this just a philosophical exercise, or is this man on the island important to us? Do we care? Well, we only have one response to this. There's only one right response to, is he important? We think about that silly scenario I gave you at the beginning. How did he get there? You know, boat capsizes or whatever, and he floats to that island, and there he grows up and survives. What's his only hope? His only hope is that another boat shows up. And on that boat is somebody with the gospel. Because that's the only means. Romans 10:14 and 15 verify this. Listen to the rhetorical way that Paul poses the question. The answer is obvious. How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How's it going to happen? How are they to believe in him of whom they've never heard? How's it going to happen? How are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. Our only answer that's biblical to the question, is he important, is this: the only hope he's got is the gospel. Now, somebody may argue this and say, wait, hold up. How about, I got a counterpoint to that. How about Acts chapter 10? Here's Cornelius. Acts chapter 10 describes Cornelius in glowing terms. Cornelius has obviously had some pre-gospel exposure to the truths of God, perhaps through people in the synagogue, perhaps through neighbors. The Bible calls him a God-fearer. So God is already at work in him in some way because he's reading the scriptures. He's trying to live them out. He's trying to find the God that he knows. Is he saved? Is Cornelius saved? No. Not until Peter shows up and brings him the gospel. It's always the gospel. It's a response to the gospel that saves us. That's what's required of all of us. Or what about Peter, James, and John? After the resurrection of Christ and the gift of the Holy Spirit, their whole personas changed. Their whole ministry changes. Now they're bold men for the gospel. Peter stands up in Acts chapter 3 and tells the city, this man that you crucified, his name is Jesus. He's resurrected. He's Savior and Lord. In Acts chapter 4, they're defending the miraculous that they've done. They're defending the work of the gospel. Acts chapter 4, verse 5 says, the next day their rulers, elders, scribes gathered together, the high priest, Caiaphas, John, Alexander, all those of the high priestly family. They set them in their midst and says, by what power or name did you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. What theological point are they making? Belief in God is insufficient to save. For all of you believe in God. Religion? Insufficient to save. You're very religious people. He's speaking to the high priest and the high priestly family. All your religious deeds and activities, your sacrifices and all the things that you do, insufficient to save. What is required for salvation? That you respond to a person with a name. His name is Jesus, a person who was crucified and rose again. They're doing no less than verifying what Jesus said about himself. Right? John 14, 6. Jesus said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And listen, if you have a different answer than the one I've just given you about this man on the island and his importance and our response to it, then I would suggest to you that our entire strategy as Christians, our particular strategy as Southern Baptist Christians, and our specific application of that strategy in terms of things like the Lottie Moon offering is very, very misguided. Because if we really believe that a person in that condition who's never heard of Jesus, who's never had a scripture story read to them, who's never heard God's law and what God's expectations are, who's never had a bit of Bible, a bit of gospel given to them, if we really think they're innocent as a result of that, then we need to flip our strategy completely upside down. And instead of expending millions upon millions of dollars to get the gospel on a boat or a plane or a car or a train to those people who've never heard it, we should do all in our power to make sure that they never hear it. We should preserve their innocence. Because the last thing we want to do is expose 2.9 billion people who don't know Jesus to the gospel that would condemn them if they heard it. But that's not what we believe. We believe there's hope and no other apart from Jesus Christ. We believe that God has demonstrated his mercy towards us in giving us a gospel message. We believe that God has given that gospel message to the world. And he's given the church the mission of conveying it. Now, why do I say that our only response to this is the name of Jesus? Why do I say that if we think about this man as being important, that our only right response is to say, no, he's got to know Jesus. No, he's got to trust Jesus. He's got to respond to Jesus. He's got to trust and put his faith in and become a follower of Jesus. Why? Let me say something to you that might shake you just a little bit, but hear me out. The primary purpose of God in this world is not to get people to heaven. It's not. That's not primary. See, that sort of taints all of our thinking. Well, God just wants to get everybody to heaven. So we think in some of our misguided understanding that, you know, it doesn't matter how you live. It doesn't matter if you respond to the lordship of Christ. It doesn't matter if you become part of his kingdom and live under his rule and reign in your life. If you would just say this prayer, this little simple magic formula prayer, you kind of get God over a barrel, and then you get into heaven. Everything else is gravy, right? You can live like hell the rest of your life, but die and know you're going to go to heaven. And we wouldn't say it that way because that doesn't make for a very good gospel track or a very good crusade message. But it's almost the doctrine we believe sometimes. Just pray this prayer as a child, ask Jesus into your heart. It doesn't matter what it does to you or if there's any effect whatsoever, because now you get heaven, and that's all God cares about is you getting heaven. But the glory of salvation is primarily about the Savior, not about the sinner. And what God wants is worshipers. And what God is really after, what God is really after in the lives of all of us is in Romans 14, 11. As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to me. His primary business is not to get people to heaven. His primary business is to have worshipers of King Jesus. That's what the gospel is about. The gospel is about all those people in this world who worship something else. It doesn't matter. Is it a prehistoric view of God and they worship a coconut, a sea turtle? Or is it a misguided version of God that they've designed that looks more like a man than the Almighty? Is someone they call Jesus but has nothing in common with the Jesus of the Bible? Well, we're very clever at making so many different gods of so many different types. And what God is about is the glory of his Son. And to turn people's hearts towards Christ Jesus, King Jesus, the returning King Jesus, that we would bow before him and follow him. That's why when Jesus came giving the gospel, he called it the gospel of the kingdom. Not the gospel of heaven. Heaven is a result. Heaven is an effect. But it comes from those who will surrender to Jesus as King and Lord of your life. So I think about your response to this message today. And I'm not your Holy Spirit by any means. If God is leading you to a different response I'm about to share, then so be it. I'm thinking and hoping that maybe some of these responses will come today. Maybe that some of you will say, you know, I got to be honest. I've been lazy when it comes to my study of Scripture, and you're telling me things about God I didn't even know, or just that doesn't fit my understanding of God. Well, you got a tough choice now, right? Are you going to conform to what Scripture says and your beliefs adjusted to that, or are you going to say, no, I'm going to keep believing what I've always believed. I'm going to hold on to my own false views. For some of you, your response may be just that. God, I got to study. I got to know. I want to know who you really are so I can follow you and love you and serve you. Another response might be this today. Some of you as Christians in this room might feel the compulsion, not of my words, but of the Holy Spirit to say, I got to go. I got to tell somebody. I got to tell somebody. It may be for a week on a short-term mission trip. It may be for a month, a year, a lifetime. It may be going across the planet. It may be going across the street. But I got to tell somebody about Jesus. And maybe the third response is this today. Maybe some of you you've heard this before. Maybe some of you have heard this a lot. To whom much has been given, much is required. And when Jesus went through those cities proclaiming the gospel, demonstrating the gospel, and they didn't repent, he said, you know what's really better for you? It would have been better for you if you'd lived the most godless life possible and been destroyed off the face of the earth when you face everlasting judgment than to have trampled underfoot the good news. Than to reject the gospel of grace, to outrage the spirit of grace. So maybe today, maybe it's dawned on you, I cannot keep hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing this without responding. God is holding you to a high standard of accountability and the consequences for you, and now you know. And I can't say I'm sorry that you came. I'm glad that you came. Because we all perish. If we perish without Christ, whether we perish with the law and the knowledge of it or without it, we still perish. But if we make Jesus Christ Savior King, the promise of God is everlasting life for those who believe. All have sinned, no doubt. All fall short of the glory of God. The wages of the sin is death, Paul teaches, the Bible teaches. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. And that's your call today. What will you do with it? I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes this morning. Just everybody all over the room, as we respond.